And we are live. Ciao, ciao, everybody, and welcome to episode 59 of Jello Ciao Ciao. I'm Creep. How you doing, Chris?
Hey, and you know we're only 10 episodes away from episode 69. Yeah.
Oh my gosh. We're going to have to do something filthy.
Like watch a Jello. And you know what? This is the first time I think we've started it right at 9 o'clock, so... Congratulations to us.
Yes.
It's amazing. Hi, everybody. Yes, absolutely. Here we are.
Oh, fuck.
Hey, is that working?
Yeah. Are you at the lake?
Get the fuck out of here. It's actually working? That never happened before. All right. Hey, listen, I'm not going to... Okay. For those of you listening to the audio version, I just turned on my Google effects, and it started working after... How many episodes did I complain?
I think those always work. I've seen you with dumb shit on your face before, but maybe not this much.
It might not have been anything to do with Google, though. Let me see if my lower third actually shows now, because that would be awesome.
It does.
What the fuck? Are you kidding me?
Maybe you just need to update something.
I didn't update a goddamn thing. Nothing. Nothing's been updated. Oh well, but now you can't see my it's sure. 7 a.m. somewhere t-shirt, but that's okay. So yeah, what's up everybody? Here we are. My son the other day, I just have to mention this, okay. We were at my mom's house and we were in the pool and we play this game called Color Shark, which is basically somebody stands on the diving board and they stand with their back to the people in the pool. And then they pick a topic like favorite color. And I guess that's where Color Shark comes from. And so they just shout out colors. And when you hear the color that's your favorite, you have to swim to the other side of the pool as quietly as possible.
Yeah.
And if the person on the diving board hears you go, they jump in and then try to tag you and then you're it. So the topic on Sunday was scariest movie that you want to see or that you have seen or something like that. And my son's only 7, so he hasn't seen that many scary movies. And at one point, he turned to me and he goes, "Dad, what's yours? Is it a Gallo? Is it some sort of a Gallo movie?" And I'm like, "What? A what? What do you mean Gallo?" He's like, "You know that podcast you do." I'm like, "Oh, a Giallo? Yeah, probably. But my favorite scary movie is not a Giallo." So, anyway, but I thought that was interesting that he was picking up on that.
What did you swim on?
What did I swim on? Nobody guessed it, but I think my favorite scary movie is The Shining.
Yeah, so. Pretty good. That's a good one. We used to play that game all the time as a kid, but I don't remember if that's what we called it.
Yeah, I think it's kids have a way of kind of repurposing old games and giving them new names, and pretending that that no one's ever played them before, so that they can be the first to truth or dare somebody into something ridiculous. I don't know. But yeah, it was pretty cool. I was like, oh, my son knows about Giallo movies. At least one of my copies of So Deadly, So Perverse had been laying out on the desk, and it's the one, I think it's the second edition with the picture from one of the Lamberto Bava films with the woman who has like her bare ass showing and then the glove with the knife in front of it. And I remember my son seeing that and making a comment about that this woman's butt was sticking out. So it's all coming back to me. It's the chickens are coming home to roost at some point with my son. I'll come home one day and he'll be like watching Dawn of the Dead and I won't know whether to scold him or sit down and finish watching it with him. So we'll see.
Yeah, my daughter just turned 13 and I don't know what the hell I'm doing anymore.
I can't even imagine.
It's bonkers, dude. I don't understand anything.
I got 9 more years before that happens. So
cherish those years, my friend.
That's what they all say.
So do you have any other like updates of anything of any kind?
No, not really. I think we probably need to mention that Bud Spencer just passed away. He was what was he famous? I mean, from the Giallo standpoint, he was in Four Flies on Grey Velvet, but I don't know what he was.
He was in a bunch of spaghetti westerns and shit.
Oh, okay. So I haven't dedicated any time to watching those yet. So,
well, actually, I just watched Django the other night with Franco Nero, the original one. And that was pretty fun. I've never seen that.
I would like to see that.
I also watched that Eurocrime documentary.
Oh, is it good?
Yes and no. Like, the interview segments were good, but like the sound throughout the whole movie was off. So like some interviews are really quiet, some are really loud, some they're not even really focused right, or it's like and then they would put like just like a sheet that you could see all the creases and folds in it behind people, and so that was really annoying. But then like they probably said to themselves, like, we have something really cool here, but no one's going to buy this piece of shit. So then they had like someone put a ton of effects in it, like just like animations and cool like flash cut scenes, a lot of music, but it almost got too much because like we started watching it and I think no one starts actually talking until the 7 minute mark.
Oh, wow.
So for 7 minutes, it's like flash, boom, flash, boom, flash, boom. And you're just like, fucking kill me, you know, like, but other than that, it was a really good watch and got me into watching some Poliziotesco.
So cool.
I've been watching a bunch of that lately. I watched Violent Naples and The Cynic, the Rat, and the Fist. And then I started just downloading other stuff. And let me tell you, I can't remember what the girl's name is. It's like Greta something or Gilda something.
Right. But
there's this movie called Blue Jeans. Have you seen it? It is interesting, to say the least. It's basically about a dude who gets, he finds his 17-year-old daughter who's a hooker. And then the whole rest of the movie, he's wondering if he should do her or not. Very strange film.
Wow.
But then she was in another movie that we started watching today, and it was just so raunchy. Like, I just stopped it, shockingly enough, because it was too early. But I think it was called The Teasers or something like that.
Wow.
Just a lot of pubic hair and stuff.
Oh, okay. That one. Well, that one's coming up. 1975 as a comedy. The Teasers, would it be, would you consider it a comedy?
I guess, with a lot of bush.
Yeah, interesting.
But
yeah,
I thought it was a crime, like a Euro crime, and like you have to wait like, I don't know, like an hour and 20 minutes before the crime happens.
Oh boy.
And then the movie ends and you're like, oh.
I really want to see that one where that has that famous Barbara Boucher strip tease scene in it. I forget what it's called. Just because that scene, I don't know if any of the rest of the movie is any good, but that one scene is just like unbelievable.
Is
like
that that one that was someone put a clip on the page a while back?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, that was cool.
I forget what it's called, but I think that's like Barbara Boucher. She's been featured in a lot of things over the over a longer span of time in the 60s and 70s, but there's like a peak period where she looks better than ever. And it's the same thing with Edwidge. There's a point in which Edwidge looks a little bit, I don't want to say trashy because that's not what it is. Like she cuts her hair short, not like the pixie cut from Strip Nude, but like this kind of medium length, kind of curly. And yeah,
that's what the early 80s did to all the actresses from the 70s.
Yeah.
Like the actresses that came out of the 80s were fine, but the ones that were trying to transition from like 70s hottie to like MILF of the 80s.
Right.
I don't know what the fuck happened.
They didn't do a good job.
Yeah. Something awful in Italy in the early 80s made all of these women just look like the fucking fifth Golden Girl. I don't know.
Yeah, exactly.
Something isn't right.
Totally. And there's another picture I every once in a while that I see of Edwidge, and I feel like I feel like it's so awful. But they the photographer, it looks like he told her to suck in her stomach as hard as possible before he took the picture.
Is it the one where she's leaning up against like a wooden wall, like a?
I don't know. It just like you can see like the tops of the bottom of her rib cage, and you can see like her belly's all sucked in. You could tell that she was sucking it in because she has a little bit of a pooch, which is very attractive as far as I'm concerned. But I guess at the time they were like, well, you know, everybody's got to have this, you know, flat stomach. And she looked like she was sucking it in pretty bad. But
yeah.
But there's the film that we might do or that we're planning to do next time, which is a Muck. I think Barbara Boucher looks fantastic in that film too.
Okay.
So whatever year that was from, I think 1970 maybe. But at any rate, we're jumping ahead here.
Yeah.
I did want to mention, we may need to change this first contest for the Giallo playing cards. I'm going to hold them up here. Let me go back and just reiterate what the contest was.
Okay.
For those of you who may have missed last episodes or who may have missed the post on our page, I'm going to look down and scroll down and see if I can find it. By the way, whoever shared me that fun Fulci fact sheet.
That was awesome.
It's so cool. It's like the coolest thing I've ever seen. It's so nerdy. Right up the alley of Giallo score. So anyway, we were talking about giving away this first deck of Giallo playing cards, and I don't have the post in front of me, unfortunately. Now, the contest was that in the washing machine film, which we covered last time, there were four classical pieces. I think when we did the podcast, I said there were three, but I went back before I posted it onto the group site, and I identified four different pieces. And the winner of the deck of cards was going to be the first person who correctly identified all the pieces. Now, when we talked about this last time, I said that I only knew the first one. Now, I went back and figured out the first piece and the third and the fourth. I still can't figure out what the second one is. So I'm leaving that kind of up to the audience. But we didn't get any hits on that at all. No one made any attempt. So
that's a hard question.
I guess it's a little too hard. I guess part of the problem is you have to have a copy of the film in the first place, and the washing machine isn't necessarily easy to come by because it's not on YouTube. So you have to try to find like a bootleg copy, or you have to buy a copy from Shameless or what have you. So we'll give it another week and see if anybody, if we can kind of revise or revitalize the idea. But if not, we'll, you know, maybe we'll change it to, you know, identify one of the four things, that one of the four classical pieces in that film, not all four of them. Maybe that would be easier. In fact, that's what I'm going to do. Let's just do that now. just to get some movement on this thing. So the contest has been revised. I'll post it to the group, everybody. Identify at least one of the classical pieces that are featured in the washing machine.
Person gets it.
The first person to correctly identify one of them and tell me which one is which, you know, don't just say, oh, it's this one. What the minute mark is when this particular piece is played would be helpful. I can give you guys a hint too, because the very last piece that was in the film, what was the guy's name? In the movie that they thought was dead in the washing machine, Yuri, I think that was his name, right?
Spoiler.
Yeah, sorry. He was dead in the washing machine. He wasn't dead in the washing machine. At the very end, he says, and while you and so-and-so were off enjoying, and then he says the name of the piece. So if you go back and listen to it, you can get that. So I'm giving you guys some help here. I want to give these away. It's the Giallo playing card.
They're so cool.
They're so cool. Yes, we have more. So don't think we're going to go easy for the next deck. But we'll find something that maybe is a little easier, because I thought this would be at least get a couple of hits, but we did. So no worries.
The only other update thing I have, it has nothing to do with this show, but actually there's two things. One, I just signed a deal for 11 of my movies for with this one company. So
wow, some of that's them awesome.
Have already been released from other companies, and some of them have never been released. And they're going to be pushing really hard for Redbox. So
cool. Congratulations. See.
That would be cool.
Amazing.
And then the other thing is, I have two new podcasts, if anyone gives a shit. One is about Atari 2600, and that's called Atari Concast, if anyone gives a shit. And the other one is a black metal podcast called Black Metal Moments. So if anyone gives a shit about that.
Wow. Black Metal Moments.
Yes. We've done Venom's Welcome to Hell, Sodom's Witching Metal, and the next episode is the Merciful Fate EP. So
love Merciful
Good Fate. Times.
Yep.
Yeah. All right. So
is it all dedicated to satanic metal specifically?
I'm trying to chronologically cover the releases in black metal from the first wave through the second wave and into modern time.
Oh, okay.
It's going to take me extremely long time.
So do you consider Welcome to Hell to be like the very first kind of real black metal album? That's cool. Excellent.
Yeah. But so I was 81, so I'm an 82 right now, and I'll be an 82 for another few episodes.
Nice.
Good.
When I was in, I think, 8th grade or 7th grade, I got this video cassette called The Ultimate Revenge Concert, and it was Exodus, Venom, and Slayer. And they had interviews with Slayer, and there's a interview where Dave Lombardo and I guess Tom Araya were talking about how much their music sounds like Bach. And then in the middle of the interview, somebody throws a piece of like lunch meat at Dave Lombardo, and he catches it in his mouth and just chomps it. And like some kind of crazy animal that was just thrown some raw meat. It's like the most ridiculous thing ever. But I forget where it was filmed, somewhere in New York City, some club in New York City, but it's on YouTube. Look it up. The Ultimate Revenge Tour with Slayer, Venom, and Exodus. And Jeff Hanneman's on there. He's not even alive anymore. It's just crazy.
Yeah. Didn't he die from a spider bite?
Yeah. He had something fasciitis of his arm or something like that. They said it was a spider bite, but then I thought I read something about there being some complications with alcoholism, but I don't know. I thought it was a spider, but there was a picture of his arm that had this crazy skin graft on it, and they thought he was getting better, and then he died. So I don't know. He's pretty fucked up though. But anyway.
Yeah, moving right along.
Yeah.
moving right along. Tonight we are doing two George Hilton movies, and I was a little upset because I thought the email said Paris Hilton movies. I watched House of Wax twice.
You didn't watch a night. What was it? Inside a night in Paris. I think that was the name of it, right?
No, but I saw Backdoor to China, but that's a whole other situation. But no. So George Hilton, and we're going over Two Faces of Fear and The Killer Must Kill Again. And out of these two films, Two Faces of Fear, I think, is the worst title.
Yeah.
Don't really understand it.
I think maybe because there were so many different situations where they had those surgical masks on and they just kept doing those close-ups over and over and over and over again.
Which we'll talk about.
But the film is like, it has a movie poster that's completely wrong. I don't know if you've seen that one, but it's a picture of George Hilton and he looks like he's laying on the ground and standing over him is a killer, a black gloved hand with a knife that's right above his face. And that never happened in the movie.
But you want to know why they did that, probably?
Well, because for the promotion,
every
right?
movie George Hilton's in, he's the bad guy.
Right.
9 times out of 10. And I will say this, that I decided to take that theory and throw it in the trash can when I watch these two movies. So we'll talk about what happens next. So first we're going to talk about Two Faces of Fear. So let me get on that. It's from 1972. Let me actually try to not fuck up a bunch of names. It was directed by Tullio Demicelli and stars George Hilton, the king of the Jolly, Fernando Rey, who I believe is more of an American actor. He was in like the French Connection and movies like that and stuff. And then we have Luciana Paluzzi. Oh my God, I'm gonna die. Did you hear that?
Was that thunder?
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, I'm outside. This probably is a horrible idea.
You shouldn't mention her name again.
I know. It's like fucking Young Frankenstein. Fjabruer. and Anita Strangeberger. And then a bunch of other people that nobody knows or remembers. So,
And I must say that Luciana Paluzzi is very, very hot.
Fucking no shit, dude. And the funny thing is, she was a Bond girl, kind of. She was in Thunderball. And Thunderball's the one, if I'm not mistaken, that wasn't really in the canon. It was made by a different company after Sean Connery said he would never do another James Bond movie. So she is a Bond girl, but for that other company. But yeah, I was like looking at other things I've seen her in, and I think she looks the best in this. Like, she was just stunning in this, I thought. She made Strangeberger look strange.
Yeah, I just found this picture of her all in leather, like on this motorcycle, and it's amazing.
That's a pretty hot picture, I'm not going to lie. but I really think in this movie she's just fantastic. So let me read the plot summary of this from IMDb, and then I'll explain something. A professor's wife falls in love with her husband's assistant. When she learns he's planning to move to another city, she does everything she can to avoid it, with no success. Soon afterwards, he is found dead in obscure circumstances. I think that's just fucking not accurate by any stretch of the imagination. First of all, he's not a professor. He's a surgeon. And the problem with this movie, if there is a problem, here it comes. I'm going to get struck by lightning here in a minute. Live on the Chow Chow.
It's not like you're talking about Citizen Kane. It's just some dumb giallo, right?
Yeah. But the thing is, out of every giallo I've ever seen, I think that this movie is the only one that I had no idea what the plot was for the first like half hour, and it completely didn't matter.
Right.
I didn't care at all. It was still interesting. It was still moving forward. But basically, Luciana, her character's name is Elena, I think. Let me see here. Elena. Yeah. Okay. So Elena Carli is married to Roberto Carli, who is George Hilton. Their best friends, I guess, is Dr. Michelle Azzini, but it's not Michelle. They said something else in the dub. I can't remember. And Paola. Damn it, I knew a girl with this name too. How do you say it? Paola?
It's like Paola. Instead of Paolo, it's the female version. So Paola. But I think it's like Paula, right?
Yeah, we'll say Paula. So Paula Lombardi, who is Dr. Azzini's fiance, and she's also a surgeon or a helper bee or some fucking thing. She works at the clinic. Now, as far as I could understand how this movie starts off, Alina is almost an invalid. She has a heart condition or some shit.
Right.
Her dad started this clinic, I guess, and hired Michelle or Dr. Anzini to like work there or whatever. And he's like the best there is. He wants to leave to go to some other place. And Alina's wanting to kind of give him parts of the clinic, like give him a percentage of the clinic to help him, to make him stay. And for some reason, Strangeburger doesn't want him to take any offer, which doesn't make any fucking sense, as you'll find out later, I think. And then they have some other guy that kind of runs it. Is that Luisi?
Yes.
Or wait, no. Yeah. Okay. So he kind of runs
the place. The guy who plays the inspector in the other movie we're going to talk about later. Okay.
Yeah. So basically, you have these five people, and someone is hiding inside Dr. Anzini's home office with a parrot. And he has some paper with the offer from the other company that's really important for some reason. Long story short, he's shot and killed, and the papers go missing or whatever. So now we have a list of suspects. We have George Hilton, Strangeburger, Alina, the super hot invalid, and then the guy from the other movie. We'll call him Lou.
Yeah.
Now, this movie starts off fast and furious and all this stuff, with the exception of the weird story that doesn't make any fucking sense. It doesn't matter. Then walks in Inspector Nardi, played by Fernando Rey. Now, as you've seen in a lot of these giallo movies, the police officers usually bring in the comic relief. This guy's comic relief is that he just quit smoking and he's pissed off every time someone lights a cigarette. And every single person, even if they've never smoked in the movie before, as soon as he walks in the room, they're going to light a cigarette so he can have some like fun playtime. Then he has a partner who's a complete idiot, supposedly. And his only job the entire movie is to question the parrot. And he fucking, there's a scene where he actually slaps the bird across the face. And I was like, what? But so he's trying to fucking interrogate a parrot who's the only witness to this murder. The other guy is being just like a weird cop. And this movie, as much as it was, it really did not feel like a giallo, like at all, with the exception of the murder. Now, this has the same feel as those like late 60s giallos that are like really fun and don't really have like Jean Sorlin and fucking Carol Baker should have been in this movie.
Yeah, definitely.
It felt like. Anyway, so I'm trying to think of, okay, so powering through here a little bit, the whole time and there's spoilers abound, so if you don't want to know, stop. The whole time I'm like going, it's gotta be Alina. It's gotta be her. It's gotta be her. And then she gets followed and she gets chased by this dude. And she's like freaking out, and the chasing goes on for fucking ever. Like it's a foot chase.
Yeah.
And she gets on a bus. He gets in a taxi. She runs in the subway. He gets on the train too. She runs home and then she collapses. And then I thought, oh fuck, she's dead. Damn it. She can't be the killer. But then she's not dead and she's in the hospital and she's going to have open heart surgery. And the only person who could do it is her husband. It sounds like a bad riddle that's about to start. And not only is her husband there doing the operation, but Strangeburger's there too, who, by the way, for some reason looks a lot better with a face mask and a hairnet.
She does. And I noticed that she didn't have the boob implants yet. I don't know if you noticed that. The very beginning scene where her fiance, the guy who gets killed, the doctor gets killed.
Yeah.
There's a scene where I guess he comes to her house. He's got like a little nightgown on.
Box.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, she didn't really have a bikini on, so you couldn't really tell, but it looked to me like she hadn't gotten the, although you know what? That probably doesn't make any sense though, because Two Faces of Fear came out in 72.
Yeah.
Her breast implants were really obvious in Lizard and a Woman's Skin. And I'm just looking it up to see when that came out. 1971. So my theory is completely wrong.
Well, I will say this, for like the first like 6 months after implants are put in, they're all fucked up.
Yeah. And especially probably back then too.
They have to settle. So that might have been what the problem was there. Could have been fresh. But anyway, let's get off of Strange Burger's titties for a second here.
Why?
So it turns out that through all of this, Strange Burger is in fact banging George Hilton behind her dead boyfriend's back and behind George Hilton's wife's back. And then it turns out that the girl who's getting heart surgery right now was also banging the dead doctor.
Right.
So they were swingers and they didn't even know it. Right. So that's confusing. So she doesn't want to get crisscross. she doesn't want to get her heart surgery done by George Hilton, her husband, for some reason. And I think it's because she thinks she's going to die during surgery. And the surgery has real fucking footage of surgery, heart surgery, that completely caught me off guard. And I had a hard time watching this because I can't watch real stuff. And it was very long and very suspenseful. It was probably one of the most suspenseful bits in one of these movies I've seen in a long time.
Yeah.
And so I'm like, oh man, she's going to die on the operating table. She can't be the killer. And then all of a sudden she makes it through the operation. And I'm like, fuck, she is the killer. I can't believe they just let her live so she could get arrested or something. And then somebody comes and kills her. And I was like, fucking hell. So it was like a giant emotional roller coaster for me. and then through a couple of awesome little things that the detective does, George Hilton finally does get busted for the murder. And I should have fucking known better.
Yes, absolutely.
I think I messaged you like, fucking God damn it. Like,
should have known better, right?
Should have fucking known better every time. Fucking, with the exception of like maybe like two movies, he's like fucking screwed me.
Right. Well, when you messaged me, I said, well, wait a minute, which ones wasn't he the killer? And My Dear Killer, he was the police inspector. And then All the Colors of the Dark, he was the husband who wasn't involved in anything. Killer
in Case of the Bloody Iris? No.
He was not.
No. So then there's three.
Yep.
Okay.
But there's a lot more where he was.
Yeah.
But well, anyway, I was going to say, I thought the same thing about the surgery scene. Like, not only was it very suspenseful and difficult to watch just because it's like kind of
makes
me squeamish, but they did a really good job with taking the footage that was real and interjecting it with the scenes of the actors. Cause I did not see the copy of the movie that I had. There was a thing that shows in the beginning that I think explains that the movie contains footage from some certain open heart surgery footage, but it was in Italian or Spanish and I didn't read it. I just like, oh, I'll see that later. So I wasn't prepared to see real surgery footage. And halfway through, I was still trying to question like, man, they did some really good effects here.
First cut it open, I'm like, oh, that looks fake as shit. And then I'm like, that's a pig.
Right, right. That's what I thought.
Yeah.
I thought they were doing it on an animal or something. But yeah, the whole idea that they had this fake, you know, artificial heart ready to go, and then they were going to do this surgery, and then he was going to use his hand to massage it to make it beat until it started catching up with itself again. I mean, it's crazy. While that's going on, at the same time, there was this clue that they found. I guess it was Elena's earring.
Yeah.
And they found it at the dead doctor's house, right? And then they saw the video or the film that they made, and they were able to tie the earring to her. But
which is awesome, because they make this video of all five of them shooting off the same gun. And it's them that killed the doctor. So they're like, so everyone could use this weapon.
They all know how to fire it, right? And there's a scene in the very beginning, and you should have known. One of the very first scenes is George Hilton, and he's got the gun, and he closed one of his eyes, and he's got his wife in his sights, and then she turns around, and she's out of focus in the background, and she turns around.
There's 100 times when you should have known, because I think after she's in the hospital, that Lou guy picks up Strange Burger, and they start accusing one another of like being the killer.
Right. Okay,
so if it's not the wife and it's not those two, the only person left is George Hilton.
Right.
So, like, but it's just like the whole time you're going, it can't be that simple. And, like, he dropped the papers out of his pocket in the very beginning of the movie. They were stolen from his office. And you're like, oh, someone must have planted him there.
Yeah, he's, like, so cool. He's like, darling, how could you think this? You know they're not mine. Of course they're not mine. Like, he's just so cool the whole time. Like, that's George Hilton's deal. Like, he's always playing it cool no matter what. Like, even at the very end when he's revealed as the killer and they do those close-ups and it's Strange Burger's eyes and eyebrows and his eyes and eyebrows. And he gives one of these, like, puppy dog looks. You can only see his eyes and his eyebrows, but you know he's doing the, oh, please have – you know, have pity on me, you know, that kind of thing. And that's George Hilton, man. He's always garnering sympathy from everybody, even though he's like evil bastard.
I think the way the cop finds out it's him is actually kind of clever. It almost is so clever it doesn't even make sense. But I think we should not say that and let people watch that, because that was like I was like, what? Like, they totally had me fooled. And then all
of a sudden, I have to go back again and check out that detail, because I don't even think I remember. I know it had something to do with a couple other clues that they found.
I'll just read it anyway.
So never mind.
Basically, he's telling George Hilton in his office right after the wife's been found dead or whatever, that he has Strange Burger at the dead doctor's apartment, and that she's going to be arrested.
For the
murder.
Yep, the sting.
The phone rings, and his partner's like, "Oh my gosh, you got to get here quick! Strange Burger just swallowed a bottle of barbiturates, and she's dying."
Right.
So George Hilton freaks out, and they run out to the car, and George Hilton drives like a maniac all the way over there, and they get into the apartment. And Strange Burger stands up and she's fine. And he's like, see, 12 minutes. It only took 12 minutes to get here. You totally could have killed the doctor in that time.
Right.
And then he's like, oh, fuck.
You got me. Yeah.
Shit.
But wasn't there something else with the gloves and the talcum and
talcum powder? Yeah.
The hair that they found?
He had like a wrist hair in the glove that when they first pulled it out, I thought for sure it was a pube. And I'm like, that's gross.
Well, there was a scene during the surgery where I could have sworn they stuck one of the gloves in with the heart, but it was really just gauze to soak up the blood. But for a second, I'm like, that's how he's going to kill her. He took the evidence of his glove and he's going to stuff it in with her heart and then sew her back up and she's going to die because she has a rubber glove in her chest cavity. And now that's how he not only kills her, but gets rid of the evidence.
Well, when you were talking about how seamlessly they cut the together. There was one bit. There's one shot of the doctor messing with the heart, and it's kind of over the doctor's shoulder, and you could see that the doctor has glasses on, and he didn't have glasses. So that's
That's interesting. I have to go back and check that out. A little continuity thing.
Other than that, I mean, that whole bit was just freaking flawless. And to be fair, there wasn't really any nudity in this movie of any kind. It's a very clean-ish film.
Right.
And again, the girl who plays Alina is just stunning in this movie.
Yeah.
The first outfit she has on, that red thing with the gold hoops around the neck, amazing. Fantastic. And then the next time you see her, she's in this weird fucking multi-green, like, pantsuit thing. Yep. And they're sitting her against grass. Like she's fucking camouflaged or something. And
I remember that. That was cool.
And it was like, what the fuck is going on here? But yeah, so, I mean, as much as this movie is kind of forgetful, it really isn't. I'm kind of indifferent, but leaning more towards this was really good and everyone should watch it.
Yeah, I think that the cast really helps to propel the film along. I think I had the same reaction that you did when they started the film and it was like, okay, here's these four like very well-to-do aristocrats that are super rich and they're all talking about this relationship, and then this one weird thing that has to do with the one doctor who wants to leave, and then she Elena is basically offering him like I guess a counter offer to stay or something like that. The beginning reminded me of Cat of Nine Tails, because somebody broke in to the doctor's room or the doctor's office and tried to steal some papers. And again, why they decided to steal the papers, I don't know. But then,
papers, grab the papers and fucking leave. Don't sit there, make a bag of popcorn and fucking read two papers.
Yeah. And check. And didn't the hidden figure go over to the, machine too? There was a thing about the answering machine where one of the calls was erased or something.
Yeah.
That was part of the investigation.
Another thing too was right before he got shot, he like smiled and nodded like he knew who his killer was.
Right.
So right off the bat, you know, it's one of these.
It's one of them. Yeah. People. It would have to be, right?
Yeah, it totally would.
I love the slow motion shot of him like falling over the coffee table with the flowers. Yeah. That's a really cool shot. And the thing with the surgery I don't know why I'm drawing this parallel, but if you remember from the Bloodstained Butterfly, they spent a lot of time with the trial, the court case of the guy who they thought was the guy who did the made the murdering. That's good English. The guy who committed the murder. You like that, right?
Dude, I'm putting coffee on my nose.
I made the murdering.
Wow, it's like J.J. Abrams is fucking directing this podcast right now. Lens flare. It's pretty nice.
So, and I think with this one, the whole centerpiece of the film was this surgery scene. So it was like very similar to that. So there wasn't a lot of blood. There was only two murders. And like you said, it's a lot more of a suspense slash mystery kind of a deal instead of a stalker slasher kind of thing, and which is weird in one way because we're in 1972, which is like the pinnacle of the giallo movement. But at the same time, there's something to be said, I guess, for the fact that here you've got this Argentinian director who really never did anything from the giallo world at all, who's just a spaghetti western person. And it's like, well, we're all directing these giallos now because they're the flavor of the month or the flavor of the year or whatever. And he secured a decent size budget, obviously, to be able to do all this with the surgery and all the medical equipment and these actors. But maybe they just decided, you know what, let's not do the same old stalking killer thing. Let's do something a little different. And so I think that's why it stands out as a unique film simply because of, you know, what we expect from a George Hilton giallo in 1972. And this definitely wasn't it, even though it turns out that he's still the bad guy.
But it's still really worth it. It's like refreshing almost.
Yeah, I agree.
What did it get on the score?
It did terrible on the score. Got a 41.
Did you give it points for the airplane?
I did.
As soon as I saw that, I'm like, oh, Chris better fucking give him points for that.
Yeah, they did such a good job of making you think that it was a real airplane that just for a split second that I had to give it the point. But it lost a ton of points because for the main reasons is that basically you've got a director who's not an Italian and you don't have any black gloves. And then basically, you know, the character played by George Hilton basically just gets, you know, handcuffed and he goes away. He leaves quietly in the end. And that's not really, that doesn't get you a lot of points. So, you know, assuming
a George Hilton staple.
Yeah, he doesn't go quietly. Or the killers once they're revealed, they typically don't go quietly. They either get shot, or they run up to the top of a cliff and jump off, or they get thrown down a well or something like that. But those 40 points that it lost, if it had those, then we would have had an 81 scoring film. So you know, it falls into the I had trouble trying to decide whether to give it the final vote as entertaining, even though it's not a groundbreaking film, but it's still entertaining, or one of those worthwhile deviations, because it really didn't deviate too much. When we had a mystery, we had a hidden identity of a killer, we had a couple of murders and some suspects and a police investigation. So it really didn't deviate too much.
It didn't have the whole formula detective thing, though.
No.
Like, that cop was, I don't know, like, at first the jokes were annoying me, and then they weren't annoying me, and then they started annoying me again.
Right. Well, again, I'm going back to Bloodstained Butterfly, I think, which was the running gag about the coffee dispensing machine was never making his espresso exactly the way he wanted it. And every time they brought him another cup of this coffee, it was either too cold or too sweet or too strong. Or
It's like, if you've seen White Zombie, there's this, the original White Zombie with Bela Lugosi, there's this character who's constantly trying to find a match for his pipe. And so there's like a scene going on and it's all fucking like intense and all this stuff. And he's like, have you caught a match? And then the movie ends on him saying, huh, but do you have a match? And it's like, it's like, you fucking asshole. Like,
yeah. Right.
So
they,
yeah,
they did that in pieces too, I think, because Christopher George's character is walking around asking for a match constantly. And he's like, give it up, Lieutenant. It's a dirty habit.
I probably already talked about the White Zombie thing then, because that's always bugged the shit out of me.
No, I don't know. Maybe I just don't remember, but I don't think we talked about it before. But
okay.
The other thing with this film was the soundtrack. It wasn't necessarily forgettable, but it wasn't necessarily memorable either.
I can't remember it at all.
Yeah, I think that there was a couple of scenes where they're driving around where there's some funky stuff going on. But this is one of those films, and I think the next one too, where I didn't pay too close attention to the soundtrack that much, which is not normal.
I watched both of them yesterday, and I can't remember any music in either one of them.
Yeah. I think the one for the next film, for the second film we're going to do, there's the opening credits is like there's this really kind of spooky, scary, gothic kind of stuff going on. But then there's
let's move on from this. Like, I like Two Faces of Fear. You like Two Faces of Fear. It's kind of weird. Let's go to the next film.
And the only thing that I want to say about this one is the Spanish title, which I screwed up actually on Giallo score. I have the Spanish title in as the Italian title, but it's Corazzata en Disco Rojo. And I looked up coartada, and it means alibi. Now, disco rojo means red disc or red wheel.
Or Red Club.
Yeah, so I don't know what
Disco Punk. I'm just kidding. I don't know.
alibi. What does that mean? A red disc of your alibi, or your alibi is in a red disc. I don't get it.
Don't
Maybe
know.
somebody can explain that to us who listens to the podcast.
Maybe it's the Club of Red Alibis.
I guess. I'm going to switch it over. Whatever the other one was, the Italian one. Yeah, all right, so let's move on. That's cool. So we're moving ahead in our George Hilton double feature to a very interesting film called The Killer Must Kill Again. Dun, dun,
Again.
dun,
Totally.
dun. And so this is a film directed by Luigi Cozzi in 1975. It stars George Hilton, as we all know. And this was Luigi Cozzi's first real film after this experimental kind of student film he made called Tunnel Under the World, which was a sci-fi, low-budget sci-fi film. And apparently, the legend has it that Tunnel Under the World attracted the attention of Dario Argento, who recruited Cozzi to help with Argento's screenwriting. And I think Argento directed this in 1973, this made-for-TV couple of episodes, like The Door to Darkness, I think it was called, and Luigi Cozzi directed one of the episodes there. So he's well known for his sci-fi and like fantasy, like sword and sandal epic movies, but his very first, real like professional film was this Killer Must Kill Again, which was released in 1975, and is kind of considered a giallo. We'll talk about why it might or might not be. The fun fact is that Luigi Cozzi wanted to call the film The Spider, but I guess for marketing purposes, that wasn't going to fly. So they called it The Killer Must Kill Again. But if you watch the film, the opening credits, the imagery is all over the opening credits of the spider. And I think at the very end,
It's a spider.
when the credits roll, it says the spider in Italian, as at before the credits start to
And then
scroll
next
up.
to the credits, there's a spider.
Yeah. And a web at one point or another. So also it looks like this film was produced at least in part by Umberto Lenzi, which is our favorite proto-giallo guy. So we've got some heavy hitters in here. In addition to George Hilton, we have a couple of actors that show up in various other Italian things, but we have Christina Galbo, who's the Spanish actress who was in What Have You Done to Solange. She plays the lead character's secret girlfriend, who ends up eventually getting killed in the bathtub. And the other actor who plays the killer, his name is Antoine Saint John. He was also in The Beyond. He was in the beginning, black and white, or sepia. If you watch that movie, it's not even a black and white. It's a brown and white sepia flashback scene of Fulci's The Beyond, and he's like the guy who they think is practicing some sort of witchcraft, and so they come in their boats and they crucify him and they nail him to the wall and they throw horrible, like rotting, like acid in his face and whatever. And so that's him. He's from that movie. He plays the killer in this one. Music is by Nando De Luca, who is very, very unknown. He's only got like seven soundtracks to his credit, which, as we all know, when you're talking about Jolly, having 100 films to your credit is not abnormal if you're a composer in this time period. So the film opens with this killer who never really actually has a name. They never say what his real name is or his character's name.
We know his initials.
We know his initials, unless it's unless it's from a lighter that he stole from somebody else. But it starts with this killer kind of finishing up, cleaning up from this murder, working to dispose of this body. He's got this very bright red Volkswagen Bug and a body. And he's a deviant. He's got some sexual problems. He's feeling up the corpse after he puts her in the car. And then I guess drives away. And then we see the opening credits. So we're supposed to, you know, as a viewer, we're supposed to really pay attention to what just happened. But then after the credits are done, we meet Giorgio and Norma, who have this very, very yellow house. I mean, I've never seen a house. And it was really awesome, but it didn't look practical. It didn't look like you could really live there. It looked fantastic, though. I thought it was great.
It was amazing. It was total, like, eye porn.
Oh, yeah. And, I mean, those the bulbs that were, like, poking out from the side of the light bulbs, the track lighting that was along the side of the wall, and there's some blue in the curtains. I mean, it was amazing. That house, I would love to see it. It's probably not really a house. It's probably just the studio set up. Yeah. It was gorgeous. So they're fighting about money. She's telling him that he's a bastard because he's cheating on her with all these women. And he's talking about how he has to take this money out of the bank because he's trying to run the business and her father doesn't like him and all this other stuff. And they have this fight. And he says, go screw yourself. You're nuts. You're going to be in the mental institution. I'm leaving. And he goes out and just drives away. So he pulls over to make a phone call, I guess, to the girl he's cheating with.
Francesca.
And he witnesses this our killer showing up in his red Bug, getting out of the car and pushing the car into the canal or the lake or whatever it is to dispose of the crime. And it's very much an establishing kind of scene, very much like Bird with the Crystal Plumage, where, you know, everything traces back to that one scene where the main character is trapped between the two pieces of glass. So in this particular case, Giorgio confronts this killer and says, hey, you know what? I'm going to blackmail you. I will pay you, though, which is weird. But I want you to kill my wife. Basically, he's trying to get all the money. I think Norma had this life insurance policy.
Crisscross.
Another crisscross. But, I mean, it was, he wasn't going to kill anybody, so it really wasn't too much of a crisscross. But so the killer's like, yeah, okay, whatever. They go to this ice skating rink, and he's like, yeah, okay, fine. So Giorgio returns home, and he makes up with Norma, and they have sex, and everything's great. And Giorgio's like, I think I found a solution to all of our problems. And then the funny scene happens where Giorgio meets the killer again in the movie theater. And if the trivia here is that they're actually screening Luigi Cozzi's first film, this low-budget sci-fi film called Tunnel Under the World, in the movie theater when these two characters are talking. And there's a scene in the very beginning where the projectionist sticks his face to look in out at the theater to see, you know, who's in the theater, and that's the director. At least from the notes that I read on the film, that's his little cameo in the film. So they meet again, and they have a little bit more discussion about the details. And Giorgio says, look, just come by my house, say, you know, say you're meeting up with me, and go in my house and kill my wife. And I'll get you the rest of the money once I get it. You know, I get it from my father-in-law, and so on and so forth. So then we go to this scene where the killer goes to kill Norma. And I thought they did a really good job with this whole juxtaposition thing where as Norma is getting more and more scared and more suspicious of this figure that she's let into her house who claims to be friends with her husband, we see Giorgio at this party and everybody's laughing and he's telling jokes. And then she gets strangled and he's holding up his champagne glasses and toasting to the evening. So I thought it was really cool how they kind of interjected those two scenes together. I mean, to basically show that they were happening simultaneously, but like the two ends of the spectrum of emotion. So basically, Norma is dead and the killer now needs to dispose of the body. But here's the problem. These two crazy kids decide that they're going to go over to the car. Now, I think it was the killer's car, or was it Giorgio's car. I can't remember.
It was the killer's car.
It was the killer's car.
Yeah.
So he left the car with the door open and the keys in the car. So these two hippie kids come by and steal the car.
After the body's already in the trunk.
Right. Good point. Thank you for reminding me about that, because that was clearly the big thing. So yeah, the killer comes out, puts the body in the trunk, and then goes back in to clean up the rest of the stuff and comes back out and the car is gone. So the killer is forced to steal another car and go after them. And that's really where this movie switches into its main phase, which is what's going to happen next. It's not so much about, okay, we know there's a killer. We know there's an investigation. We know there's, you know, there's clues that people are trying to follow. It's none of that. It reminds me more of Mario Bava's Rabid Dogs, yeah, where basically the people in the car and what's going to happen next and what's going to happen next, you know? So, and it's suspenseful. It's really interesting. What was that?
It's like a Tarantino movie, you know?
Yeah,
it's like,
I think so.
A random thing happens and then all of these ridiculous things happen after it, you know, like a domino effect of hell.
Yeah, it's very Tarantino, or maybe very, something that, you know, maybe Tarantino was,
well, Tarantino ripped off all the Italian directors anyway. So,
right.
Yeah. Okay. Moving right along.
So the kids, you know, they steal gas, they keep driving, they drive all night long to get to this wonderful, horrible beach. It's supposed to be the thing that they've been talking about for hours. They've been, you know, the girl who just happens to be a virgin. She plays a virgin in Solange too, which is interesting. So she's a virgin and she wants it to be, you know, the right time and the right place and feel the right way and all this other stuff. And they arrive at this beach that they've been fantasizing about for miles and miles and miles. And it's awful. It's like this little tiny, like, piece of dirt with the ocean. And I would like to ask any of our Italian friends or our Italian correspondent, if this is a typical, you know, is this typical when Italians say we're going to the beach, is this typically what they expect? And I'm totally just spoiled by the beaches that we have in the United States. Like, I live near the Jersey Shore, so that's like, you know, Atlantic City and Wildwood and Seaside Heights and that whole thing. Like, that's the beach, the way that I think of it, these long stretches of beach. And, you know, for a creep on the West Coast, same thing. Like, yeah, you know, the Santa Monica and that whole thing, or Venice. But maybe in Italy, this is what people are used to, as this is what you do when you go to the beach. So I'd love to hear from the folks that say, yeah, this is not typical. This is typical of what a good beach day is, because I know that places in France and places in Spain, that's not what the beach looks like. So I don't know if it's just Italy.
The funny thing is about it, it's called Seagull Rock.
Seagull Rock. That's right.
And after they say that once, and it like does like a transition to them at the place, they show a picture of a seagull and then show a picture of a rock.
Like, and that's kind of interesting too, because I wonder how that translates, right? Is there such a thing? Like, did they say, you know, the rock, you know, Seagull Rock in Italian? Does that translate exactly the same way? And so they did that scene, or did they do it specifically for the English version? I don't know. Or did they film that scene with the seagull and the rock and then later decide in the English language version that that's what they would call the beach, because they already have a picture of the seagull and the rock, so why not call it that? But anyway, and Cozy does these cool things where he does these what is that device called where you just zoom in the,
it's like what they would do in silent movies and shit. Like
a negative spotlight where the whole scene goes black except for the circle that focuses on this one thing.
Yeah.
Where they get to the toll booth and, like, we didn't need that. I mean, we know what the car looked like. And, you know, they did the overdub of what they said when they were at the toll booth. But I thought that was funny that they did that. So, So basically, the Laura character, she's not happy with this beach. So they say, hey, let's break into this abandoned house. So they break into the abandoned house, and Luca goes and finds some sort of inflatable, like, air mattress, which he can't inflate because it's got too many holes in it. And so he's like, what are we going to do? And like, I'm trying so hard to fuck this girl. I mean, I'm doing everything. I've drove all night long listening to your nonsense.
I stole a fucking car.
I stole a car. I stole gas. I stole money from the gas guy. We drove all the way to the beach. You don't like the beach. Now we broke into a house. I mean, how many more crimes do I have to commit before we have sex, right? So she says, look, I'm hungry. Go out and get me some food. And he's like, all right, fine, but this is it. I'm not doing anything else.
Oh, ridiculous.
So Luca leaves, and he's driving his car, and he runs into this damsel in distress whose car's broken down, this blonde girl who's also super hot. But she's a whore. Like, she's like a total, like, not a whore, but she's like a tramp. She's like, oh, I got this beautiful guy here, and let's pull over to the side and bang, you know, in the middle of in the middle of the road, like on a dead end part of the road. So meanwhile, the killer shows up, and he goes into the house, and they do
Sorry.
What's that?
I knew she looked really familiar. She's the redheaded chick from Strip Nude for Your Killer.
Oh, yes, she is. That's right. Did you just look that up, or did we get...
Yeah, I just looked it up.
Oh, okay. Yeah, thank you for mentioning that, because I know, it's like, I've seen her somewhere. So meanwhile, the killer shows up, and then they do this really hard to watch double scene again, where they juxtapose the sex scene between the hitchhiker and Luca, and then the rape scene of Laura and the killer. And the killer's like saying things like "I love you" to her, and he's clearly like fucked up, like he's got some serious problems. He's not just a hitman for hire. Like, he's not just this professional killer. Like, he's got serious issues. Is that the wolves?
Yeah.
It's so awesome.
Jesus Christ, dude.
They're mourning the deflowering of Laura in the film.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it was like, this was pretty heavy stuff at this point, because it's very suspenseful. Laura, who's been fighting this whole time to not have sex until she's really ready, gets forced to have it anyway.
And the look on her face the whole time is just terrifying.
Yeah, it's really bad. She's got tears in her eyes, and she looks like she's, you know, in shock. So after that all happens, the killer ties her up. And then Luca comes back. He's hoping to have this threesome going on. But when he finds Laura tied up, the killer knocks him out. And the killer leaves the house and sees the blonde who's discovered the body in the trunk. And so he brings her in and says, oh, yeah, well, these two guys, they're the killers. Come with me, and the inspector will be here soon. And he coaxes her into the house under these false pretenses, and then ends up stabbing her to death. Which is a pretty violent scene as well. Like, this stabbing thing, I thought was pretty well done, well orchestrated. So at the end, the Laura character finds a way to kind of free herself by, I guess, using the knife to cut her bonds. While the killer's like, now that he's killed this blonde girl, he's kind of fucked up. Like, he's walking around, and he's, for whatever reason, he's distraught, or he's got some.
He's like in like a trance or something.
I don't know why, but you know, something was affecting him. So Laura uses that opportunity to get the jump on him and stab him, and she finally kills him. So meanwhile, while all of this is going on, we have this weird kind of police investigation where it's really not an investigation, because you can tell the whole time that the inspector suspects and knows that it's Giorgio, and that he's just biding his time until he has all the evidence that he needs. Because he already knows that Norma had a huge insurance policy, and that he went and talked to Norma's father, and he didn't have any nice things to say about Giorgio. So I think it was already assumed that from the inspector's point of view, that this guy was guilty party, or was at least involved in this kidnapping, because some things just didn't add up, and things didn't happen correctly or whatever. So, somehow, despite the fact that these two kids drove miles and miles and miles over to the beach. It's still within the jurisdiction of this inspector. I don't know why. Maybe because they found the body of the girl. Maybe that's why he gets called in. They don't really explain that. They also don't explain who the killer was killing in the very beginning. Like, nobody knows who that is. It's never touched on at all. I guess
they never got the car out of the water.
No, they never did. So the inspector stages this sting, which is very, I found it ridiculously ironic and interesting that we picked these two movies with George Hilton, and they're randomly picked, but they both end exactly the same way. So
yeah.
The police set up a sting to capture Giorgio. He finds the car. He finds the body in the car, I think, and decides that he's going to drive it off and brings it over to the same spot where the other car was pushed into the lake. And before he can do it, the cops capture him, and he just says, "What? So
fucking stupid! Like, this body's been rotting in a trunk for a day and a half.
Right.
Hey, let's leave the body in the trunk just to freak him out. Like,
right.
So like." Just ridiculous. I don't know.
I guess he wouldn't, you know, I guess they assumed he wouldn't do anything if he just found the car without the body in it, right? Because he could just pretend that he didn't know whose car it was if it wasn't him. So then he gives up, like, very willingly, just like the other movie, and says something about, let's go. It's cold out here. I'm cold now.
It's getting really cold outside.
Which is really weird. So this is an interesting film. First of all, I thought it was very good. I think it was really well done. The suspense was well done, and it's definitely a film that I would watch again, because it was it was fun to see how the events kind of unfold. I don't know if it would be as fun the second or third time through, because that whole surprise factor of what's going to happen next is kind of ruined. But then again, you know, you can watch Tarantino movies over and over again too. So it's kind of like there's some movies where they did it effectively enough so that even though the real surprise is already ruined, or at least you know what the outcome is, you still watch it anyway because you're anticipating one scene to the next. But it's interesting about this film and the fact that it's called a giallo, or considered a giallo, because there's no real mystery. The only mystery is what's going to happen next. Like, what's going to end up happening to the killer? How is he going to resolve this? And what's going to happen to Giorgio? Because he's revealed right in the beginning. His face is clearly visible, and we know who's in on it. But it still has a lot of the same kind of giallo elements. There's a body count. There's a flashback. There's an accomplice. It's an urban location. We do have a police investigation. We don't have an amateur detective, but we have a police investigation. And so it didn't do well in a giallo score. It did as bad as the other one. It got a 42. But this is, again, because of the fact that, you know, it loses a lot of points in the staples section, where you don't have black gloves. You don't really have a killer who's on the loose or a hidden identity, which are typically very big deals in this type of film. So but at the same time, it really does feel like a giallo more than anything else, although it does have a lot of kind of like a thriller, almost kind of a slasher aspect to it, suspense. But you're talking about 1975 too, so I mean, you know, they were trying to do something different. The director, This is his one attempt at a giallo, so maybe he decided to do something a little bit more unique. I don't know.
Yeah.
But I've been talking about it a lot, so what do you think about it, Creep?
Well, first off, the killer is probably the most menacing-looking killer I've seen in any movie. Like, he's fucking terrifying. And the dubbing they did on his voice was, like, fucking perfect. Like, it was so, like, it was so terrifying. And I think probably the biggest surprise of the movie for me was when he came out and his car wasn't there. Because the whole beginning of the movie, you're like, dude, this guy's the most professional fucking killer in the world. This is fucking crazy. Like,
right.
George Hilton's got in way too deep, blah, 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 blah. But then he's
exactly.
like, oops, I lost my car.
Yeah.
this is dumb as anybody else. And he's like, fuck. And it was just like, it's such a weird thing to happen to the main antagonist of a movie. Like, on a whim, his car gets stolen while he's fucking cleaning up a crime scene.
Yeah.
It's just, it's so, like, it's like one of those ideas that someone probably had, like, when they were driving home from work, like a total random thought, like, oh my God, what if like a killer was disposing a body and someone stole his fucking car? That's hysterical.
Right. Right.
Movie about it. The thing totally. About George Hilton, though, is I'm sure they made him look a little older, but he just looked, I've never seen him look so tired.
Yeah, he totally like, looked tired.
He looked beat in this yep. movie. And this is the first time that whoever did his voiceover, his dubbing, wasn't the same guy that's done it every other time I've seen it.
Yeah.
So his voice, it like threw me as soon as he started talking, because I'm so used to the same guy doing his dubbing on every fucking movie.
Right.
So when he started talking, I was like, what the fuck is going on, dude? But I mean, the star of the movie besides the killer is their fucking apartment. It's like the most amazing looking thing. Like if you just want to see how badass a yellow apartment can look,
yeah,
watch this movie. It's the same kind of thing like with Strange Case of Miss Ward. That weird ass apartment with the green and white stripes. It's like so bizarre that like you just want to like pause it and stare at it.
Yeah.
And like there's this weird, like I think it's like a see-through like plexiglass table with these weird chairs.
Yes.
And like everything in this apartment is so fucking weird, but it all matches.
Yeah. And it looked like they spent a lot of time designing that room.
Fucking hell, dude. It was beautiful.
Yeah.
And the movie was well done. I mean, like the whole thing where he leaves the girl and he ends up fucking some other chick while she's getting raped and stuff. Like it's smart. I mean, there were some things like the place that they broke into looked fine, except for this one room. It looked like it was just trashed.
Yeah.
As soon as they walk in, they're like, wow, it doesn't look like anyone's been here for years. I'm like, actually, it looks pretty fucking clean as you're going up those stairs.
Yeah.
It's just when you get into that main room that it looks like a fucking bomb went off. But I don't know. It was like when the killer gets killed, to me, it almost happened too soon. It's almost like George Hilton's the real villain the whole time.
Right.
The killer was just like a dog he let loose. So it's like the dog goes down, but it doesn't fucking matter because you blame the owner, you know? So.
And that's interesting. That's interesting too, because like it was totally random that Giorgio ran into this guy and it just happened to witness him doing this. And like you said, you know, in the beginning you're like, okay, this guy is professional. He's clearly not fucking around. And you know, maybe George Hilton is really getting in over his head with this guy, and maybe what's going to happen is that the guy is going to come back and get Giorgio. That's
what I thought the whole fucking time.
Right. And then it turns out, like you said, that he's totally like foul. Like he's human, and not only did he lose the car and have to steal another car, and like how tense was that one moment where he's fumbling with hot wiring it and the alarm's going off and the lights and the lights in the neighbors' houses are going off and he's got to like fly out of there. And then, you know, just some of the other stuff, like when he finally gets stabbed a couple times and he gives her this look like, oh, well, looks like you got me, and then falls over.
The look on his face when he's raping her, he's like, he's seriously one of the scariest looking dudes I have ever seen. He's just fucking.
And I don't know if his face, if they did stuff with the makeup to make his face look alien or a little bit weird, or if that's just the way he looks, but he's just got this really strange look about the forehead and the eyes just like bulging out. And
like, I don't know if he's ever done a movie where he was the good guy in it, but that would be a shit movie.
It wouldn't be very convincing. That's for sure.
Holy cow. He's the love interest. Hey,
can you imagine?
Oh, jeez. My God. But I don't know. He just made the movie. George Hilton, I mean, except for the beginning and the end, he's almost an afterthought.
Yeah.
And the star of this movie, besides that apartment, is the killer. And the two kids that steal the car, they're idiots the whole time. And they're pulling shit like in a slasher movie in the 80s. You're like, why are you fucking doing this? You guys are so fucking stupid. Don't do that. Don't go down there.
Right.
It's like, as soon as she goes down in the basement, you're like screaming, like, you stupid fucking bitch, get out of the fucking basement.
Right.
You know? So it's, it's really, really good. Like, I don't know. He was amazing.
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah, I agree. I like both of these films and I would definitely watch them both again. And I think, the whole point of this episode is that it's, you know, a George Hilton double feature. And I think that he really does make both of these films more entertaining than they would be if he wasn't in them. So,
yeah.
So bravo to George Hilton. What I'll try to poke him on Facebook and see if he wants to listen to the podcast and maybe come on. Cause I know he's like doing stuff now. I don't know if he speaks English, but he's active again. He's in a film, like he's listed as being in a film that's in production right now. And he's on Facebook and he's posting pictures of himself. And
yeah, you
know, so it would be interesting.
That's how I found out that dude died.
Oh yeah.
He posted something about it.
Interesting.
But it would be really great to ask him if he thought it was a good idea to run off with the car at the end of that movie. Cause I thought that was the stupidest idea in the fucking history of the world. Like, that just has guilt written all over him, dude.
Oh, yeah. Well, like I said, I don't know if you're trying to make sense of it all, and it's like, okay, here comes Giorgio, and he still feels like he's under a bit of suspicion, but he's just got all this money that he's going to use for ransom. He's gonna wait to hear from the killer. Eventually and pay him off. And, you know, he's feeling like he's getting close to the end of this thing. And then all of a sudden he finds the car and the passenger or the driver's door is open and the trunk is open and he opens the trunk and he sees his wife in there. Like, I mean, I don't know what would you do at that point? I mean, I guess the only alternative would be to say, let me call the cops and pretend that I don't know anything about this.
Yeah.
But
then he lit the police guy's cigarette with the fucking bad lighter. Awful. But anyway, yeah.
Two very cool films. I enjoyed them.
So, are we going to do the top 10? Cause we've been doing two movies at a time and then you guys did that one movie without me that one week, but
that's right. So do let me go through and see how many films we have, because
there should be 19 after next week, I think.
Right. We started with episode 51, right? And that was the first episode after Eric left the show.
I think.
And that was episode 51. It didn't have any films. We did a recap of the genre. We did a Back to Basics episode. So then the next episode after that was the Redemption Tour, where we did Bay of Blood and Black Belly of the Tarantula. And then after that, we started with I think we did four Lenzi films in a row. And then so on and so on and so on. We did the two Paul Naschy films. So yeah, we've got a bunch of stuff, and I think, you know, we need to do a top 10, but it's more than 10. So,
yeah, let's just put them in order.
We'll put them in order. You want to do that for next time? Let's do that for next time. Sure. And that will include the two that we're going to cover next time, which is the Barbara Boucher episode. As much as we love George Hilton and his manly spaghetti Western giallo ways, we're much more interested in Barbara Boucher and her exquisite body and gorgeous blonde hair. So next week, and this is a result of the polling that we did on our Facebook group page, where we asked our loyal followers to pick the next few films. And it turned out that this George Hilton double episode won by, I think, one vote. So
but then there was another poll, like a little further down, that had Amok and the other movie winning. What is it, French Sex Murders? Is that right?
Oh, did that one win? So I think what happened was I put the poll up with, I think, 5 or 6 or 7 choices. And when it was time to close the poll, the George Hilton and the Barbara Boucher options were tied. So I redid the poll with just those two. And the George Hilton one won. So, but we'll do, you know, we'll do Barbara Boucher next time. And that's going to be Amok and the French Sex Murders. Apparently the French Sex Murders has this interesting character who's supposed to look like Humphrey Bogart, but is really bad. I've heard really bad things about this film, but it's Barbara Boucher, and you know, what can you say about Barbara Boucher?
That's in the title.
Now, meanwhile, Amok, don't want to spoil it for anybody, but that one has the lesbian scene, which I'm very excited about watching again, with, I forget the other actress's name who's in Amok, but it's the two of them.
So is it that Mimsy chick?
It's the girl who was in.
Was she in the perfume one?
Rosabella Neri. And she was in. Let's see. She's in the French Sex Murders, too.
You know the girl from Four Flies on Grey Velvet? What's her name? Mimsy Farmer?
Yeah.
Is she in Amok?
No.
Okay. Why did I think that?
But that other girl that was in Four Flies and Grey Velvet is so hot. The cousin who comes in halfway through. So let's see, Amok. What else was she in? French Sex Murders. I know I've seen her from something. Let's see. Oh, she was in Top Sensation with Boucher. Not Barbara Boucher, with Edwidge, which we haven't done yet. But she was also in Lady Frankenstein.
We might be saving that for episode 100.
Which one? The Top Sensation?
Yeah.
It's going to take a while. Maybe episode 69. We could do that one.
Maybe.
So that'll be next. That'll be next time, and then we'll catch up with the other ones. I believe we also talked about doing some proto giallo, Naked You Die, and Libido. Libido is the one and only film directed by Ernesto Gastaldi from like 67 or something. We also talked about doing Redemption Part 2 with Eyeball, but I'm going to wait until I go to see it in the theaters. Oh, the other one that got a lot of votes was the late Argento Jolly Phenomena and Trauma. So we may decide to go and do that one too.
I wouldn't mind doing Trauma, but I could give two shits about the other one. Boom.
there's Phenomena has a lot of fans on our.
It does. I know. I know.
So, but yeah, so that'll be next time. And don't forget to go to giallochowchow.com to get all the episodes, as well as to give us some reviews on iTunes. Check out our Facebook group. For those of you who are actually listening to this podcast who aren't in the Facebook group, look us up on Facebook, Giallo Chow Chow. It's a closed group, but we're getting new members all the time, and I always am quick to respond to new requests.
And then go to Twitter, at Giallo Chow Chow.
That's right. We have a Twitter.
That we haven't done anything with in a long time. But we're going to try to start doing that more.
Yeah, I was bored at work one day and decided to sign up for Twitter so that I think we have a few folks who actually listen to our podcast who don't use Facebook. So it's another opportunity to...
And I'll hook up a stream thing so when we post an episode, it goes to that Twitter account.
Oh, cool. Excellent. Yeah, we have like 40 followers, so that's not so bad.
Someone is trying to figure out how to fix the iTunes thing because I can't figure it out.
Oh, to open up all the episodes?
Yeah.
Okay. Great.
Apparently this happens to quite a few people. So I'm having somebody look at it.
Cool. Well, that'll be great. And as always, check out JalloScore.com. I have been really dropping the ball on that site, you guys. I'm really sorry. Nice. I did publish the two episodes that we did tonight. I wrote them up today, and I was very proud of myself for getting them done. But I'm still missing the washing machine, and I'm still missing besides the washing machine, I'm missing my Bloody Valentine, as well as Blue Eyes for the Broken Doll. So those are the ones we've covered on the show that haven't made it to Jalo Score. They have been scored, but they just haven't been written up. So we'll be doing that. I'm going to try and do that as often as I, or quickly as I can. And that's it. Once again, don't forget about the contest for the deck of cards.
Just pick one song, tell us what it is, and what time it starts.
Yeah, pick one of the four classical pieces featured in the washing machine and post what it is. I will repost the question to our group so that we have it at the top, and maybe we'll pin it until the podcast episode is ready or what have you. Yeah. So that's
my gin is gone, so I think the show's over.
Your gin is gone, and there's no more juice.
So there's no more show. So that was a good episode. So ciao, ciao, everybody.
Take it easy. Ciao, ciao, everybody. See you next time.